trail. Monday's One News comma. Brunton poll had the gap between Labor and National closing somewhat. But 47 to 33 in the comma Brunton, 50 to 30 in the Reid research are still big gaps. We're just a fortnight out from polling day, as you saw on the wall, with early voting available from Saturday. 47% of us voted before polling day in 2017. Cometh the hour, cometh the woman. But the hours, Judith Collins, are running out. Welcome to the studio.
Oh, thank you, John.
How are you feeling?
Feeling really good.
It's grueling, the campaign trail, isn't it?
Well, it is, but then that's fine. I enjoy it.
Do you?
I enjoy campaigning.
What do you enjoy about it?
Well, I love dealing with the crowds. I love meeting people. I'm a very positive person. And I just really enjoy getting out there. So I love the feedback. I just really love campaigning.
Right. 47 to 33, right? That's the comma, Brunton. Reid research, a bigger gap. Mm-hmm. You're a long way behind, aren't you?
Yeah, but we're getting momentum and we're in the right direction. I just think, too, what you do in politics is, you know, we've got to sell a vision for New Zealand, and I just think we've got to have something that's better than just wallowing and excusing everything on COVID-19, and an economic vision is really important.
I want to pick up on your vision for New Zealand then. So we just had, you wouldn't have heard her because you would have been coming into the studio, but we had Agnes Kapisi-Sevier in from Barnardos. She talked about families who are struggling with the reality of putting food on the table, of affording shelter. What's your vision for them?
Well, for a start, it's jobs, obviously, but we also understand that the Treasury says that there's possibly 100,000 people lose their jobs the next 2 years. And of course, the families that Agnes is talking about are often those families. So there's no thought of welfare cuts or anything like that. I think it's really important that we get food on people's tables.
So
nobody expects that.
How will you do that?
Well, we simply said that obviously we would obviously retain the welfare system that we have, but also, John, what we've seen is far too huge costs around housing. We've seen huge costs around increasing in rents, $50 a week on average, really tough in the last 3 years.
So what would you
so
do?
We've got
what
to build more houses and build more state and community houses. I have no problem saying that because I actually really believe in housing and I really believe in people being able to build their own houses.
You were part of a government for 9 years that prima facie didn't believe in housing at all. You were selling them, you weren't building them in significant enough numbers. And when I ask you what your vision is, it's a theoretical one rather than a policy one. So what do you say to Agnes about the children she's dealing with? And you raised in the leaders' debate the material hardship measure.
Yeah,
These are sometimes children going without. What is your policy for them?
Well, you asked about housing, and I'm going to correct you on that record. So for a start, yes, National did sell some state houses, a lot of them to community housing providers, so let's get that right. Secondly, the 5,000 houses, state houses that Labor is now claiming, they're all planned, many of them funded and organised under National, because it takes time to build a house. But for instance, what we did in Christchurch after the as part of the rebuild, is we basically got out of the RMA for getting housing built. And you know me and the RMA. Let me just tell you this, John. In Christchurch, there is not a housing shortage. In Christchurch, rents have gone down, house prices have gone down. You build a lot of houses fast, you move it through, you just
get through. It's not comparable, is it? You often cite the example of Christchurch, and I think to myself, $30 billion of insurance money came into Christchurch. Private insurers paid out $20 billion. You're not comparing apples with apples. How are you going to make a difference for the children Agnes is talking about?
You've got to get housing built, and it's not just money that builds houses, John. All people, it's actually also getting rid of that red tape. And you can do it. If we decided that we were going to actually just build housing now, not 100,000 houses in 10 years, which never actually occurred, you've got to cut through that red tape because that's the one holding it.
So you were saying the RMA, getting rid of the RMA is a panacea for all ills. I mean, you and I have a running gag. Every time I ask you a question, the RMA is the answer. Well, not every time, I'm being a bit glib.
But
are you saying it will make such a difference that the problems Agnes is talking about will be solved?
No, it will not solve every problem. But actually, Agnes's problems that she's talking about, it's actually about people having work. So getting people into work is important. Keeping kids in school so they have an education, so they have the choices their parents didn't have. That is part of that solution. But actually also just getting food on people's tables is really important. And housing costs are one of the worst costs that any family has to put up with. And so, yes, building houses is important. And, John, I will not resolve from my commitment to get housing built. And we can do that.
So it's a supply side issue.
It is.
OK.
There's plenty of demand. It's about supplying it.
I want to talk about the question you asked at Grey Parra and Nelson about we want more crusher. Mm-hmm. And yet I'm reminded of what David Longie said in 1984 when he was up against Rob Muldoon. He said, if you look like an opposition, you remain one. Mm-hmm. How the hell do you get this right? Because I think the crusher persona, and I know you don't like that word, and I apologise for using it, but I think the crusher persona potentially plays to your tribe, doesn't it? It plays to the Nats. Mm-hmm. Does it play to undecided voters? Does it play to the people who, in the favourability stakes, are saying, we're not sure about Judith Collins? How the hell do you get that right?
Well, of course, John, I'm not going to play a persona because I am just me. And you know, I am a far more complex person than simply a cartoon character that someone decided to put a label on me for. But I tell you what, John, people know this about me, is that when I promise to get something done, I will get it done. And so whether or not, you know, if I'm going to promise to get housing built, I will get it built. And if I'm going to promise to do anything, I will do it.
OK, let's talk about housing. How will you get it built?
Get
rid of the RMA, right?
Well, that is very important. Okay. But we can get around it in the first place because we could fast consent development straight away. And even the current government is now talking about that with the Urban Development Authority. So, yes, you can do that.
When you fast consent development, though, we're still talking about private enterprise here, aren't we? And we're still talking about prices that are way out of the reach of the people.
No. It's also talking about state housing or community housing. I'd rather call it social housing.
So what's your commitment to building state housing?
Well, housing policy is still to come out, but I can tell you we will get these houses built. So whatever the plan is at the moment, which is, I understand it's 8,000 houses to get built, yes, we will do that. We will actually do that.
So you will do 8,000 houses?
Well, that's what the current government's plan is.
So what's I know your plan's not out yet. But what sort of numbers are we talking about?
Well, that's part of it, but the rest of the policy will be out next week. It is really important to understand. I understand housing, John, and I understand that is the single biggest cost that families have, particularly in Auckland and in the urban areas. And when I first started practising law, you could buy a house, not a great house, but a house with about, you know, mortgage about three times your salary is what you'd be buying. Nowadays in Auckland, it's £9,000-£10,000. It's simply unaffordable for many families. So yeah, I am making housing a priority, and it's for low income people. And by the way, actually, people should be able to buy their own house.
Okay.
And I'm telling you, we can do it. We've done it in Christchurch. I know you want to talk about insurance cover, but you know what? The money doesn't actually get done. It's everything else as well.
So when is the housing policy out?
That'll be out next week.
Okay. Mm. You join us on Wednesday. Will it be out by then? Because I'd love to talk to you about it.
I think it probably will be. I'm very positive about housing, John, because I know you don't want people living in cars. I don't want 20,000 people or 18,000 people on the State House waiting list as it is at the moment. I want people to be housed.
I look forward to discussing the details of the policy with you.
We can do it.
Yeah, thank you. Long day today. We really appreciate you.
Yeah, it is a long day, but you know what? That's what I get. That's my job.
Okay. Judith Collins, thank you so much for joining us. We really appreciate you coming to the studio. Yeah.